Okay, so in this lecture, so it was Paul Dirac who came up with this very useful notation for vectors, right? So we will also follow his approach and you write vectors which are enclosed inside these, there is a straight line followed by a useful name like x, y, z, so on, and then there are these angular brackets which have this orientation, right? So these will be used to denote vectors, right? So what goes inside is something which is, an instructive aspect of the vector, right? It's not a there's no hard and fast rule what should appear inside here, but vectors will be enclosed inside these, this symbol. Now we will also use, another kind of these angular brackets which are in the opposite direction, which will be called bra vectors. We'll introduce these later on. So Dirac used this for in the context of bra and ket. So he broke this word bracket, and then we will see that these brackets also appear later on. And you probably have seen this if you have taken a course on quantum mechanics, right? So let's start with just these ket vectors. At some later point, we will introduce the notion of a dual space and bra vectors will come in later on. Okay, so and typically we will use alphas and betas and gammas and so on to denote scalars, right? So for our purposes, scalars will be either complex numbers or in some cases they may be real numbers, right? So mathematicians would be more careful and or they would want to keep this even more general and sort of think of these scalars as belonging to some field, and there is a more abstract way of defining it. But as physicists, it is sufficient for us to think of these scalars as, either real numbers, which is a special, subset of the type of problems or vector spaces which we'll be looking at. But in general, alphas, betas, gammas will be complex numbers. Okay, so we define, vectors as, these objects which are denoted using these symbols, and they satisfy certain, rules. There are these operations. You can what do you what can you do with the vectors? You can add vectors, right? So there is also the operation of addition must be defined. If you're thinking of a vector, you must be able to take any two vectors and add them. Right, so there is a notion of addition which must be specified, right? And addition must be such that it must be commutative, right? So we are familiar with two-dimensional vectors, three-dimensional vectors. We already have this parallelogram law of addition and so on. But in general, addition can be some other kind of operation, provided it's commutative in nature, right? So if you add x1 and x2 in one way, in one direction or in the other direction, the result should be the same. You must get a vector which is the same whether it's x1 plus x2 or x2 plus x1, right? It must be associative, which is the statement that x1 plus x2, you put a bracket around them, you first perform this operation, you get a vector, and then you add this to a third vector x3. So it doesn't matter whether you do it in this order or if you first added x2 plus x3, and then you added x1 after you have performed this operation x2 plus x3, right? So notice that commutation and associative properties are slightly different, right? So they are not you cannot go from one to the other. They are independent properties, right? So there are spaces where commutativity may be relaxed, but associative law is very fundamental to many of these algebraic structures. But for vector spaces, commutativity is also assured, right? So we're dealing with addition. And also there are these other properties which connect to multiplication, multiplication with scalars, right? One axiom, if you wish, is if you take any vector and multiply with the scalar 1, you're going to get back the same vector. It sounds obvious, right? But it needs to be encoded as a property, right? And many of the other properties of these, vectors and vector spaces will follow if you start with some basic set of axioms. And one of them is this obvious sounding property: 1 times x is is x. And then there's associative law of multiplication. If you take two scalars and if you just first multiply these two scalars and then multiply this product with a vector, it's the same as taking the vector and multiplying one of these scalars with the vector, and then you multiply the resulting vector with another scalar. So there is associativity here with respect to multiplication of scalars. Then there are these two distributive laws which must also be satisfied, right? So if you took two scalars, if you added them and then multiplied with a vector, you will get the same answer if you multiplied each of these scalars with the vector separately and added the resulting vectors, right? That's the distributive law with respect to addition of scalars. Then there is a distributive law with respect to addition of vectors. If you took a scalar alpha and multiplied with the sum of two vectors x and y, you're going to get the same answer if you first multiplied the scalar with these two vectors, x times alpha times x and alpha times y, and if you added these two vectors, you would get the same answer, right? So these are also laws which would appear obvious in some sense because we are familiar with 2D vectors and so on. But if you have these properties laid down, then we are ready to define formally what a linear vector space is. A linear vector space is simply a collection of vectors that satisfies these properties. So the two key properties are closure under vector addition and closure under scalar multiplication. And then you need two more properties which I will explain. So closure under vector addition simply means that if you add two vectors which belong to this space, you cannot get a vector which is outside of this space. You will stay within the same space. That means the sum of two vectors drawn from this space will yield a vector which also belongs in the same space. That's what closure means. And likewise, if you multiply with any scalar, right, the scalar could be a complex number or a real number. For all the examples that we will look at, they will turn out to be either the complex field or the real field. If you multiply it by an arbitrary complex number or an arbitrary real number, any vector remains a vector which remains in the same space, right? If it is a linear vector space. And it's important that a null vector is present in the space, right? A null vector is something which, when added to any vector, will leave that vector unchanged, right? So x plus 0 will be x, right? So, and finally, there is every vector which belongs to this space will have an additive inverse, right? So such that if you add this vector with its inverse, you must get the null vector, right? So for those of you who have some exposure to groups, you might recognize that in fact, so these vector spaces will form groups under addition, right? So if you have not seen groups and if this statement means nothing to you, not to worry. So that's just a sort of a comment on the side. But the point is that a vector space is a broader algebraic structure which also has not just this composition law which is called addition, but it also has scalar multiplication, and you have all these properties associated with addition and multiplication. And so we will see that with this sort of very simple definition, many consequences will follow. So, but before we do that, let's look at a few examples, right? So the familiar 3D vectors, right? 3D vectors or 2D vectors. Of course, if you take any 3D vector and added another 3D vector, addition of course is this parallelogram law of addition that we already know, you're going to get a vector which is also a 3D vector, right? Closure under vector addition is obvious. Closure under scalar multiplication. So if you have complex coefficients, if you multiply it by another complex number, you're going to get another vector with complex components, right? So if you're using complex components, perhaps the algebraic approach of adding component wise is a better approach. But if you had real numbers, you can also visualize them. You can think of it as vectors in 3D space, and then you have this complicated parallelogram law, which is going to leave the vector, give you a vector which lies in the same space. Addition is vector addition is a closed operation. Likewise, there is closure under scalar multiplication. So the existence of a null vector is also obvious. So the null vector is simply a vector where ax equal to ay equal to az equal to 0, right? So that's the null vector. And every vector, of course, has an additive inverse, right? So if you take a vector with the component ax, ay, az, its additive inverse is going to be minus ax, minus ay, minus az. Those would be the components, right? If you add these two vectors, you're going to get the null vector. So let's look at another example, which is perhaps set of quantities which you might not think of as vectors, but they also would classify under this definition, right? That's the whole point of making this notion more abstract, is to be able to put in things into this box which you traditionally perhaps not think of as vectors. They are also vectors, right? So think of a set of continuous complex valued functions f of x. They are defined on some interval a to b. Now they also form a vector space. So every one of these functions is a vector. If you take any two complex continuous complex valued functions, if you add the two, you're going to get another continuous complex valued function on the same interval. So closure of vector addition is taken care of. So likewise, if you multiplied some function f of x of this kind with some arbitrary complex number alpha, you're going to get another function which is also a continuous complex valued function on that same interval. Therefore, closure under scalar multiplication is also taken care of. Then you can think of this function f naught of x, which is just 0 in the entire interval, right? And it's definitely a member of this space, and it's going to serve the role of the 0 vector or the null vector. And finally, if you take any vector which belongs to this space, that is some this function f of x, you can also pull out another function which is minus f of x, which is also going to be continuous complex valued. And if you add these two, you're going to get the null vector, which is 0. Therefore, every vector has an additive inverse. So all the requirements are met, and therefore this is a linear vector space. So there's a few more examples which I have put down. So the set of complex numbers, you can think of every complex number itself as a vector, right? So we may restrict this the scalars to be real numbers or complex numbers also, you can take them, right? So every complex number will have two components, right? And if you add any two complex numbers, you're going to get another complex number which lies within the same space. So vector addition is just the addition operation is the usual addition that we do of two complex numbers. And closure under vector addition is met, scalar multiplication also met, existence of zero vector is simply the zero complex number, and the additive inverse is for any complex number z, minus z is going to be its additive inverse. So just the set of complex numbers itself can be thought of as vectors in this abstract space. Also, the collection of all polynomials of degree less than n in x. If you take a polynomial whose degree is n or less than n and add it to another polynomial whose degree is less than n or equal to n, you're going to get a third polynomial whose degree is also going to be less than or equal to n. So closure under vector addition is met. So likewise, you can convince yourself that closure under scalar multiplication, existence of a null vector, and existence of additive inverse, all these properties are met. So indeed, collection of polynomials of degree less than n in X is also a linear vector space. Likewise, the set of all complex n column vectors. So think of just a vector with just n components. So it's a little bit like your the first example. The first example was just 3D vectors which connected to our experience, but you can generalize this to n column vectors. So it will have n components, and then you can quickly verify that all these properties of a linear vector space are satisfied. So these are all some examples. So the point to note here is we started with familiar 2D vectors or 3D vectors, thinking of them of objects which have you know, magnitude and direction, and which add in a certain way, and we have generalized it, and now we can think of even objects which you know, traditionally you might not think of them as vectors, and they also satisfy these properties. And many times these other quantities will have other kinds of structure as well, and still they also play the role of vectors and they form a vector space. So the whole point of, you know, this approach here is to abstract out these properties and just ask what all consequences come from looking at these abstract properties, right? So that's what you know, the philosophy here is, and we will look at many of these properties as we go along in the next few many lectures on this topic. Thank you.